Oh yeah, looking at you right there. You know what I'm saying? Today we're actually looking for perfect sounds for live. That's today's video. Let's get into it right here and right now. Hey, what's up? I'm Analog Kitchen and thank you for checking out yet another video. Now, if this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe, hit that notification bell because you'll be updated whenever I upload a new video. But that is when you click the bell icon as well. Thank you. If you're new here, welcome and join the flow. It's a cool community. If you have questions, leave them in the comment section below and I will do my utmost, my best to answer them all. Them all. How's this look? Is that right? Ryan Zerby, Bunter Sternenhimmel, but I know his name is Chris. Lorenzo Dalcol, welcome. Patreon.com/analogkitchen. Thank you for the support. I'm building a mixer. I told you that before. If you follow this channel, you know. I do think that there's a gap in between what a club mixer and a studio mixer really can do. And we're going to build our own mixer. So it's going to be a hybrid in between that club and studio mixer. Stay tuned for that. There's a lot of guys that are actually asking me, Lucien, how do you set up a sound? How do you set up a track? How do you basically work from scratch? I mean, you see me do these videos where I basically just bump out those tracks, but the tracks have been pre-prepared. So what the thing is, I will probably show you how I get that thing going. Now, my way is not the be-all and end-all of how you are actually going to use sounds, but I have spent a lot of time trying to figure out what sounds are actually working together. I want to have sounds that are rich in transients, which means they've got a lot of overtones, that they've got a lot of grit, and they are basically overlapping. That's how I do it. So the sounds that I'm using for a live set are basically sounds that need to help each other. A little bit of a learning curve in terms of what you need to be looking for has to do with the frequency window. So the sooner you can get some basic understanding of how the frequency window works, which basically means like what's happening between the 20 hertz on one side and then 20k over on the other side, and what are the magical frequencies for your sound. So a kick usually lives in between the, what is it, 60 to 110 hertz. With peaks around 100 maybe, depending on what kind of kick you're using, obviously. And then your bass line is a low frequency, low heavy content, a low frequency based sound that probably lives around your bass line. But on the other side of the spectrum, you've got your hats, you've got your claps, you've got top loops that are there. So from the minute you pinpoint where everything sits, go and check that stuff out with a graphical equalizer. It will help you. So if you're working on a DAW like most of us are when we record stuff, obviously try and get a fab filter, EQ, or get something else that is very graphical and will show you what it is that you're actually pinpointing. Train your ears to pick up on that, and when you're doing a DAW-less live set, you know what to listen for. And from the minute you get that, then it's easier. So also, a lot of people are stacking and stacking and stacking sounds on top of each other, and then there's this bottom kick and a top kick. I really don't believe in it. I'm sorry, I just don't. You know, if you get one kick that sits well, that's that. And I hail from the days that I was actually working with a 909 drum computer. Now, we didn't change a drum kit every song that we did because, first of all, it was too expensive to do it, and second of all, 1303, 1909, it'll last you the whole night. I never heard anybody complain like, what the hell is going on? So try and keep it simple. Look for sounds that are actually going to help you. I use in my live set a drum kit that maybe the mid frequencies are changing up a little bit. So a clap might change into a snare, or a tom might change into something else, but I will stick to those frequency ranges. And I've set my stuff up in 5 specific ranges. I've got my lows, then my low mids, my high mids, and then there's my highs, and then there's that ear candy that just fluctuates up and down. So either I use a swoosh, or either I use the TB-03. That's something, there's a video that I've done over how to glue frequencies together. Especially if you've got a sound that migrates up and down within that frequency spectrum, it works. That's a lot of talk. Let's head over to the live set and let's see if I can make it work. All right, let's go. Let's see what I can do with the camera right here. Let's zoom out a little bit. Yeah, I've got everything going. So pretty much the acid box is in-house. And then I've got the Moog source right here. And then there's an MS-20 over here. So let's see what we can do today. Okay, starting from scratch, this is awkward. Usually I have something going. And my friend Dennis has made a DI box for me. So the kick is coming from this DI box, which is over here. This is just really crazy. So the kick is going through there, getting a little bit of a color there. Okay, now let's see what we have. Let's rename this. First of all, let's rename this sequence. All right, so. Right, so yeah, okay, so pretty much I've got my setup pretty going, I guess. I got really nice sounding synth. Then I've got the MS-20 today, and the MS-20 is going to just play something really like weird, you know. It's more of a groove thing rather than a sound thing. So I've got a trigger coming from the Octatrack. From the multi-clock, as you can hear. Now what I'm going to do is see if I can get nice. See, so that's something that that might be nice to add. Now, first of all, let's start with a kick. So track one on the Akai MPC Live. I'm going to start with a kick, yeah? So kick, name it kick. Play that kick in, which is how we're going to play it right here. So let's step sequence that in. So, and then the next page, we'll go to bar. Yeah, next bar. Okay, so we got it now. Yep, got my kick going. What I usually do is I'll put this on full level, which means that everything that I'm going to play is going to be like 127 in terms of velocity. You don't want your kicks to be weak in certain spots. So. Okay, so we got that. Then I heard, let's see what we have, because I heard when I was on a different page, this is the step mode page. Let's go out of this page. Ooh, I'm liking this. Okay, so this is a thick sound already. That sound I have selected. So in the Akai MPC, obviously there is like a 500 gig hard drive in there with samples that I selected. A lot of you guys been asking me, like, where do you get your sounds? How do you make your sounds? I literally just look for a lot of sounds, but I will not go out of my way to make sounds that already exist. So if I can find a sound that's already there out of a sample pack or something that I don't need to EQ, so it needs to be a cool sound, you know what I mean? And the criteria for me to pinpoint if it's a cool sound is if I play a Moog. If it fits together with this or with that, you know, it's a really big like analog source and I can gel the two together, then in my opinion, that's a sound that I don't need to work on too much. So obviously the sound that I have right here comes close. So what is it? I will call it a sub note. Yeah, S-U-B note. So N-O-T-E, right. Okay, here we go. Let's see. Oh yeah. Okay, and I'm just gonna improvise. I'm not even sure what I'm gonna play. Let's see what we're gonna do. Something like this. I can deal with this. Let's take out that hi-hat, because there's a hi-hat playing that's not supposed to play. You can see it. It's over here. So I need to take that out. Enlarge it. That sounds a bit on the loud side, so I'm going to turn it down a little bit, which is going to the pad mixer. There it is. All right, so the next thing that I want is a closed 808 or a 909 hat. Right. Obviously there's a loop playing. Yeah, that's what we like. Now what I'm going to do is press shift full level, then it's orange. When it's orange, it's playing half the velocity. So now we're going to play on track 3. It should be there now. Yep, there we go. So I'm going to rename this also closed. Closed. Nice one. Okay, what else we got? Again, so all the new sounds that I'm bringing, I'm doing that on separate tracks, because those tracks are already mapped in terms of the MIDI volumes to the Novation launch control, so I don't have to menu dive in terms of just like take care of the level. So as you can hear, see, it's easy. See, track 1 is the kick. So, okay, let's stop for a bit. I'm gonna go for a clap first. That's something that I would definitely like to do. Okay, clap, which means I'm looking for a clap. The clap, where are you? Okay, here's that. That's that. Is this a clap or is this a snare? You decide. It's a clap snare or snare clap. Yeah, it's just a piece of wood with a bit. Yeah, it's a piece of wood. All right, let's go. I don't like it. So undo. Let's see. Turn. Full level. Here we go. Go in. Half level. Now what I'm going to do with note repeat, I'm going to put it on 132. Now we can put a little bit of an effect in there. Yeah, I like it. Obviously it's very loud, so that clap needs to go down again. But first, a little bit of administration here. Got the clap. Done. All right. So what are we going to do? Let's see. Okay, turn it down. That's what we're going to do. So again, pad mute. No, pad. Go into the pad mixer. It's here. Way too loud. I bet you're gagging for a hi-hat, aren't you? Oh my god, here we go. This is what we need, full level. Let's record it, 2, 3, here we go. I missed the last one. Alright, so what I'm gonna do is put the sequence on 4, so it repeats anyway. So we're already going. Now I told you, let's take out the kick here. Yeah, nice. Turn on the filter. Open the filter again. Put the kick again. 2 and. That ride's also very loud, huh? So, ride. Ride, yes. Damn it. Akai, fix this screen, man. It's not very intuitive. Anyway, turning it down, yeah, again. So, as you notice, I'm not EQing stuff, I'm just leveling stuff. Yeah, path mixer here. Now. Now we need a clock signal. I was just playing with this internal timing thing, but now we are going to make sure that the multi-clock is sending the clock. So when I want to jam out, I'll just use this. But when I need the stuff to just gel together and work together, obviously I'm going to just like use the multi-clock for that. So we're going to start with this. In the next, in a future video, I'll probably make a kick or a drum sound out of this MS-20 as well. But for sake of not this video not over not being too long. Oh, nice. Okay. Will that work? Let's see if it works. Nice, huh? Well, that's gonna play for a while. Cool. Nice. I just got the decay open so wide that that's gonna play like forever. What I'm going to do now is see if I can play something in the Octatrack, because the Octatrack is mainly here to, let me see. All right, what I'm going to do is also go for a different pattern, which means I need to go into the MPC, go to channel 10. That's what I usually do on channel 10. I'm using the Octatrack. The Octatrack is routed through MIDI channel 9. So I'm going to put this on channel 9, yes. And it's coming out of MPC A. Yes, now that I've set that up, I can actually just go for the banks. See, that's happening, that's cool. I'll just go for bank P, because I know that nothing's playing on bank P. So pretty much what I'm going to do is scroll all the way up there. So actually when I'm changing the program here, you can actually see it's L, M, see, I'm going in the right direction now. M, N, O, P, 1, all right, P, 1, yep, Okay, P1. So on P1, what's playing on P1? Let's see what we have, because I'm using through machines, so I need to just connect 7, 6, 7, and 8 to those synthesizers that are going through here, otherwise you won't hear them. That's the Mini Tower, the Model D, and the Tetra that are going through the Octatrack. Let's see how far I go. First, let's get some sounds going. What have I got on channel 1? Let's go over to a open spot. Let's see if we can get some. There's also samples coming from here. I'm going deaf slightly, so I don't like it. So I'm going to go for chord sounds, chord synths. What I also don't like about this is that there's like the ugliest reverb ever on there. Yeah, so I'm going to use that sound. Then I'm going to edit this sound. Let's see what we have. Yeah, I'm liking this. So what I'm going to do is, yeah, I'm liking that sound. Yeah, so probably leave that little bit of a tail hanging on there. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to get out of this page. Yeah, so now it's on 1. What I'm going to do is go over to chromatic mode. Now let's play something. On this program now, the reverb I thought was coming from the L12 is actually coming from the Octa itself. So I'm going over here, let's see, going over to that program, going over here, and then turn it off slightly, play it. Volume down a little bit because it's very, very loud. And it's playing only the first of the 4 bars. So I need to just go in and, oh, this is nice. It's playing, oh no, I like it. I'm gonna stay because the third, it's 3 out of 16. So it's playing polymetric at the moment, which is what I like. So let's leave it at that. What I also do with this is, now that I've got that going, so get out of there, what I'm going to do is put reverb, if I didn't put it there already, on the crossfader, which means that I'm going to select this track. Yeah, I'm going to go out of here, which means going out of the, once you play something with the Octatrack, it's like, you know, you play the record and play button and it's blinking. Then once you recorded it, you hit it, you need to get out of there again, otherwise you're gonna alter stuff. So now that this is playing, what I want is, when I open the fader up, that there's reverb coming from the Octatrack, which is nice. I think it's already programmed already, but usually it's like your whole C down scene B, you dial in on effect 2. There's a dark verb, that's one of the reverbs, it's the best reverb out of the Octatrack in my opinion. And then the time is also very important. So what are we going to do is open this up and have the reverb linger on for a long time. So I'm going to press it, so now it's gone, because I also hear that there's something going on right here. The retrigger mode is on 2. If I'm turning that up higher, hear what happens. Which is a nice effect, but I can't have two things at the same time moving, so that's gone. Going back to that page. Dialing in the mix of the reverb and the time of the reverb. And keep in mind to not open it up completely because you'll go crazy. Nice. Now let's see, that's play. I was already enthusiastic. Now what we're going to do is like a play it. What I like about the Octatrack though is when you're in the quick mute mode, it's then you can actually perform. So now it's off. Play what we have. Build up a little bit of tension. Okay, here we go. Play it. Now, usually what I'll do if I migrate from here is I'm going to start to introduce more sounds, because there's certain things, I'm going to do a video on that as well, what needs to be sequenced and what needs to be live, you know? I mean, you can stand there and just program it in and just stand there and wait for everything to happen. But what I usually do is I got some stuff that I can actually play out live, so it's really cool. Got the filter going, you know, so that'll work. And, you know, got my mini tar, so you can add different things. To do this on the fly, I probably won't do it because it's gonna take a long time and sometimes you need to really program stuff in. So what I'll do is I've got a certain amount of beats already playing so that you're not waiting for me, and then I can play in a Moog sound or play in a Model D sound or play a Minitar sound. And those things are sequenced via MIDI. Certain things, I'm not using the looper function, so the our audio is not going, it's not getting re-looped. Something that I'm thinking of doing in the future, but my performance moves in a different way. So what I've got today is just a small demo. I can go on and on and on, but I do think you get the idea of how I work my stuff in.
Subscribe if you did not do so already. Smash that bell as well so you'll be updated and notified whenever I upload a new video, which means it's weekly. So obviously, thank you for checking this out. Links to all the equipment noted in the fold below. You can support me over on Patreon, which is patreon.com/analogkitchen. You can support me over there. I'm building a mixer, which is cool. I think it's cool. I'm doing it to get in my way, Monopoly, Dennis. Really, peace out. We're really working on it and we're trying to just come up with something with sums on it, with sends on it. It's just going to be really amazing. And it needs a sound. It's a sound one, that's it. As well as links to the equipment that I am using for the most part, that's also noted in the fold below. And everybody that keeps asking me about the case! It's a Zomo DJ case. I was supposed to put it down in the affiliate links below, but I can't find it. It's a Zomo case, a Zomo DJ case. Basically two CDJs and a DMX mixer go in there, but if you know about the kitchen, took all the lids out of there and created my own little Dallas case. So it's no more a Zomo case, it's an AK case. Oh yeah. Do you know that I'm actually looking at myself because this camera does not have a screen? It doesn't have a flip-out screen, so... You see? This is me. Oh man, look at the back of my head. Ah, stop it!